Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, and welcome to the second part of our discussion about very large databases. As a quick introduction, and in case if you missed the first part, my name is Dmitri Korotkevitch. I am Microsoft Data Platform MVP, Microsoft Certified Master, and author of a few books on SQL Server internals. Currently, I am leading the database team at Chewy.com, and I am also providing SQL Server consulting and training services to the customers from around the world. In the first part of our discussion, we spoke about different SQL Server technologies. We covered, classic row-based storage, in-memory OTP, and column store indexes, and we spoke about their benefits, downsides, and best use cases. If you have not seen that part, please download and watch that. Well, it would help us now when we are going to talk on how those things are going to work together when we are architecting and maintaining very large databases. I am also including a very large set of scripts as part of that discussion and that session. And unfortunately, we are not going to have time to cover all those scripts in demos. I also encourage you to download those scripts and play with them, and of course, email me if you have any questions. So, very large databases. If we stick with my definition, we are talking about databases, which are storing large amount of data, and at the same time, which are handling heavy and different workload simultaneously. And when you think about it, it pretty much tells you about the challenges which you may have in such environments. First of all, those databases are large. They consume a lot of data on disk, they will require powerful hardware, and well, maintenance will take forever. If you ever tried to rebuild 10 terabyte index in complex infrastructure, I am sure that you can deliver 75-minute session at that summit, sharing your experience. Second problem here is really workload. Usually, when you talk about databases with a lot of data, you will have to support different kind of queries. And system which is handling OTP just fine and can handle well large number of customers concurrently may suffer when you also need to run complex analytical data warehouse query on the same data, and that data warehouse query can affect a lot of things. It can crash buffer pool, it can introduce a lot of disk load, and it can also introduce a lot of additional side effects. So, if you want it or not, when we start to think about very large databases, we need to separate different data within those databases and kind of treat that data, separately from each other, together but separately at the same time. I am a little bit reluctant to talk about it like partitioning, because again, we are partitioning data, but we are not talking about general table partitioning, for example. We are going to talk about partitioning on much higher level. And we are going to cover that part today, but for all practical purposes, let's think about our very large databases as databases which will need to support some kind of data separation based on different requirements. And let's start with a simple one, workload. When we look at our data and when we think about our data in general, if we need to persist and maintain data for for long time, we are going to have different workloads and different requirements for the data. So for example, again, think about our retail shopping cart order entry system. Recent data in that system would handle OTP, so customers are going to run small and very fast and efficient queries, which are going to do some small selects, small updates, small data modifications. Some data which is a little bit older than that would have data warehouse workload. Again, some business analysts would run some complex queries to do their daily jobs. And in any case, we are talking about something closer to reporting and close to analytical workload here. Finally, all data may have none. I mean, again, in that particular case, we may have data just because we need to retain it for compliance purposes, or we just afraid to delete it, maybe we don't have solution to archive it, but in any case, yes, we may access the data from time to time, but it could be a very, very infrequent events. And speaking of our technologies and speaking about our situation, how we are going to handle that stuff, we need to do a very different thing with a very different kind of data. For example, OTP. Recent data is OTP, like I said. We may greatly benefit from in-memory OTP technology, or we may use B3 indexes, and we can design our table schema or data schema for such kind of data in the way which will be optimized for OTP. Like, for example, small set of non-clustered indexes, narrow, non-clustered indexes, and even kilo-cups could be, in that case, completely acceptable. When we look at our data warehouse workload, we are looking at different technology. We can either get benefits from covered non-clustered indexes, or we can get even better benefits from column store. Again, very different requirement compared to OLTP and very different approach how you would like to do that. And finally, when we start to look at our old data, the data which we are just maintaining and retaining in the database, we don't really care about workload at all. We start to care about disk space. Column store archive probably one of very good cases here. Maybe even, you know, manual compression does not really matter, but in any case, biggest challenge with such kind of data would become size and space management. In any case, as you can see, we would benefit from separating the data from each other. But there is another interesting benefit here, that if we start to think about a scenario, or let's say less ideal scenario, when everything is in the same table, you are not only limited in the technology schema and indexing in that case, but you also have issues with statistics. Because when you think about a typical way how SQL Server execute and optimize query, it needs to have statistics. And unfortunately, when you look at statistics, it has several limitations. Well, in the nutshell, statistics provide SQL Server information about data distribution in the indexes. So pretty much it maintains some data about index key values, ranges of data within index key values, and some additional statistical distribution information, like, for example, how data in those ranges have been distributed. The problem here is that regardless how big is your table, your statistics or that histogram or data distribution information is limited to 200 steps or 200 ranges. So more data you have in your table, it basically means more approximations or more aggregations you would have in those ranges. And as a result, you are losing accuracy in that particular statistics. Each step in that histogram, each range in that histogram, would cover larger and larger amount of data, which will make SQL Server Optimizer a job challenging. So in any case, as you can guess, we would like to separate the data one way or another. Well, let's say we would like to partition the data one way or another. And in order to do that, probably the most optimal way and most optimal technology which we can utilize here is really using partition views. So what is partition view? It's technically speaking a very old technology and very simple technology. You are creating multiple data tables, spreading data or separating data or partitioning data in the way you want. And next, you are creating the view at top of that, which is going to union data from all those tables and provide you the level of abstraction when you start to work with the data. So a couple of things here, of course. First of all, you will need to maintain some kind of check constraints, which will tell SQL Server what kind of data you are using in your tables, underlying tables and partition views. Those check constraints will help you in that particular case to avoid access to the tables which don't have data which you don't need. So for example, when you query your view only for November 2020 data, it would not even touch the other tables beside your orders 2020_11, because it can evaluate check constraints here. Next, that approach, and good thing about that approach, that it will provide you full flexibility. So you are not limited to the single unified schema, single unified technology, and single unified set of indexes, which you have with non-partitioned data or single table setup. You can place every table to its own file group. You can create different indexing for each table. And again, for example, for OTP data, you can create small subset of indexes and so on. But for other tables, you can create a large set of non-clustered indexes because data there is relatively static. Or you can even use column store. Or, of course, you can also use in-memory OTP tables as well, memory-optimized tables as well. And finally, you also have flexibility in terms of schema. If some data does not need to be present in your historical data, you can exclude it. You can perform some kind of ETL, you can perform normalization, denormalization based on what you would like to do. And in the end, you will abstract all the changes on partition view level. So in any case, you have all flexibility, you have all technologies, you can do whatever you want in order to make it optimal and make it happen. So in any case, one of the biggest things here is you also solve your statistics problem. Because again, in that case, you are dealing with individual tables. Each table in the view is separate table on the physical level, and you are dealing with different set of statistics here and there. So basically, pretty much you can benefit from significantly bigger statistical information, significantly more histogram steps and histogram ranges, because in that particular case you are combining the statistics across all those tables, obviously on per table level. So let's take a look how that particular setup may help us and how that particular setup may benefit us in case when we need to store a large amount of data in our database. I just want to repeat that I created a very large set of demos, but unfortunately we are not going to have time to go through all of them. So please download it, play with it, and email me if you have any questions. Coming back to our demo. So for that demo I created two different databases and populated them with exactly the same data. The first database is using classic architecture when you have one very large table here which is storing all the data. In the second case I created several tables and start to split data between them. So I have table for November, I have table for October, and I also have a big table which is storing data from January to end of September. And also for demo sake I created another table using ClusteredCom store index and store the same data from January to September as part of that table. Finally, I created two different partitioned views. One of them is combining data from all three tables which are using a row-based storage, and the second one is combining data with our column store index table. So let's take a look and see how those databases would perform. And the first, I'm going to run some query, and again, does not really matter what is the logic of that query, but what is important that we are running those queries against exactly the same data in two different databases. And when we look at our execution statistics, you can see that our query against our partition database, where data has been split between multiple tables, is significantly faster comparing to our second scenario when everything is on the very large table. Why? If you look at our execution plan, you can see that despite clustered index seek, which we have with our large not partition tables, it's still not very efficient because we are talking about relatively large table and very large number of data pages which clustered index seek needs to perform. As the opposite, if you look at our setup with multiple tables, we have different access patterns across different tables, and as a result, with our old data, SQL Server had been able to utilize smaller covered non-clustered indexes which perform significantly faster. And if we do anything, if we do something a little bit more drastic, let's see what will happen if we run our even bigger select against a table or against partition view, which also has column store indexes. And results in the case would be even more, even better for our partition setup. You see that we are about 3 times faster comparing to our classic row-based storage and large table, because a SQL Server is able to utilize column store indexes, which are, of course, significantly faster and comparing to our regular B3 index on disk. Again, you can see the plan and you have different access patterns for each tables which are involved in partition views, which is obviously needs to be done to concatenate the data. So in any case, what you may ask me, why don't we want to just simply create non-clustered column store index on the large table? And technically you can do that. And yes, it would help you with performance of your first query. But it would not really solve other problems. First of all, your database will become bigger because again, you are going to store all the data in not most storage friendly format. Second, you would not have flexibility of creating different schemas performance and different indexing strategies for different kind of data. And finally, which is also quite important, you are not also going to have a lot of benefits related to statistics. When we talk about our very large databases, usually the data in those databases is changing over time. And it's quite common that, for example, in some multi-tenant systems, some customers are coming, some customers are going, and we may have a lot of data for each particular index in statistics, but it's not necessarily going to represent the real picture how that data is changing over time, and it may become the problem. So let me show you one of such examples, and I will show you a scenario when one of our warehouse IDs, fulfillment centers in that particular order entry setup, is changing its activity pattern in the last months. Again, maybe some remodeling, maybe it's going out of business, who knows. But in any case, you can see that data in that for that warehouse had been more or less evenly distributed, except our last months where we have very little orders here. If you look at statistics, and we have index with that particular warehouse ID as a leading column, when we look at data distribution in our partition setup, basically when we have separate table and for November, you can see that you will have very, very good information about current data distribution. It will show that for that particular warehouse ID, we have just four different records. However, when you look at our classic situation with very large table, the picture would be very different. Despite that that number is correct, and despite that, yes, that particular warehouse ID has a lot of records over time across all data from the table, it would not represent you how the data in that particular warehouse ID is changing over time, which may lead to very different different results when SQL Server starts to compile queries. So let's assume that you would like to get some orders for that particular warehouse for November data. And when you run it and when you look at it, you can see completely different execution plans. For our classic large table, SQL Server will still use clustered index seek and pretty much will go through all data across all warehouses. However, for our partitioned setup in separate small table, we are using significantly more efficient non-clustered index seek, even with KLOOKUP, because we are talking about very small amount of KLOOKUP operations which we'll have to perform. And also, if you look at our I/O statistics, you can see the big difference. 1000 reads versus 14 reads. Again, good statistics here and smaller size of the table and more accurate data distribution in that statistics would allow SQL Server to perform a better cardinality estimations and generate a more efficient execution plan. Finally, I would like to also note that in our setup, our non-partition database is using 620 megabyte, while our partition database is using 370 megabyte, despite that we are storing our orders from January to September two times, one in regular table and second one in column store index. Basically, we got all that benefit, storage benefit, performance benefit and flexibility, and at the same time, we are significantly decreasing the size of our data, which we will need to maintain. So, coming back to our partition views, of course, one of the downsides when we are dealing with partition views is additional complexity, and mainly complexity when we start to work with the data. While we can select our data based on the view and SQL Server is smart enough to understand what table to access, we are going to have some issues when we need to update data. Well, issues may be not the right word, but we are going to have some challenges here. So in some cases, view can be updatable by default without the need to do anything, but it's more exception than rule, because if you want SQL Server to keep the view updatable, it will put a lot of restrictions on how you can define it. For example, you cannot have different schemas for your tables. So basically, you have two ways how you can maintain it. The first one, you can create instead of triggers on those views and pretty much put the logic inside those instead of triggers. And second approach, you can just simply make some changes in your data access code and start to work with your tables directly. Second approach is perhaps more complicated and in many cases will require some client application changes as well, but From my opinion, it's also better in terms of flexibility. So, for example, you have better control how you can deal with data modifications in underlying table, and you can also utilize technology specific things. Like, for example, if one of your tables or set of your tables is in memory OTP, you can use natively compiled stored procedures when you start to modify data in those stored procedures. But again, in either case, when you start to talk about partition views, you need to be ready to start to support a little bit more coding code in your system. So, coming back to statistics. First problem with statistics, which I already mentioned, is if you have a very large table, that statistics is not going to be accurate by definition. But there is another set of problems related to the way how SQL Server maintains statistics. If you think about default threshold, which triggers auto-update of statistics in the database, it's very large. We are talking about 20% pretty much. So basically it means that if you have 1 billion row table in your database, it would take you 200 million data modifications on the indexes before SQL Server will automatically trigger your statistics update. There are a couple of ways how you can address it. First of all, you can, of course, do statistics maintenance and statistics update manually. So you can have some kind of jobs which are doing it on daily basis, on hourly basis, and things like that. Well, should you implement it? It really depends on your data and your load and so on. But as a word of advice, if you have filtered indexes in your database, I would usually create some jobs which will update statistics at least for those particular indexes. There are some limitations in the way how SQL Server performs auto-update for filtered index statistics, and it's often beneficial to just do it manually. Second thing which you need to do is changing the 20% auto-update threshold. If you are on recent versions of SQL Server, you can change database compatibility level to 130 or above, and in that case you are going to get a different behavior when your threshold will become dynamic. So basically, based on the size of the table, SQL Server will start to update auto-update statistics more often when data grows. So it's not actually a specific number, but it's more like dynamic threshold. Larger your table is, more often SQL Server is updating auto-updating statistics. If you don't have SQL Server 2016, use trace flag 2371, which pretty much provides you exactly the same behavior, making that auto-update threshold dynamic. Word of advice, if you are enabling or controlling it over database compatibility level, remember that if you are upgrading or changing that from SQL Server, from prior SQL Server 2014, you are going to get different cardinality estimation model, which may introduce a lot of changes in your execution plans. Some for better, some for worse, but for sure you are going to have some interesting regressions in your system. Again, you can control cardinality estimation model as part of your database settings, so you may kind of enable compatibility level above 130, and you can at the same time still force SQL Server to use legacy cardinality estimator if you want to do it through database configuration. Finally, another kind of very related thing, if you have your database with a very uneven data distribution, think about it like multi-tenant system when some tenants have a lot of data, others have very few, you are going to suffer by definition from parameter sniffing and parameter sensitive plan. So basically, SQL Server may compile and cache your execution plan based on current parameter values at time of compilation. So apparently or suddenly, sometimes queries which are executing within milliseconds may start to run much longer if they were compiled with suboptimal parameter set. In any case, I found that when you talk about when you have a those situation, in many cases it's better to disable parameter sniffing, and on again new version of SQL Server you can control it from through database configuration option, database scoped configuration, or you can do it on server level in old version of SQL Server with some trace flag 4136. From my opinion, when we talk about large tables and when we talk about uneven data distribution, parameter sniffing, or actually disabling parameter sniffing, will provide you more stable execution plans, especially if you don't have time to babysit them, optimize them, and so on. So in any case, something to consider. Next backup strategy. And you pretty much have the same set of challenges. Backups are large and backups are CPU intensive, especially when you start to utilize compression. So you need to look at that from two different angles. How you can offload impact of your backups to your system, and second, how you can make those backups smaller and more manageable. So from performance standpoint, you have a couple of different things here. So first of all, if you have availability groups, consider to use secondary nodes, consider to use your read-only replicas to do your backups. It would greatly help your system because, again, in that case, you're not putting your load to main, primary server in availability group. And I can tell you that doing backups, especially when you are doing backup compression, could be quite CPU intensive. So secondary nodes definitely help. With all being said, also implement backup compression because it would dramatically reduce the size of your database backups. And in reality, it would also help you to recover your data because you are going to spend significantly more time moving large data over network comparing to, for example, spending additional overhead right now decompressing data on your during your store process. And on the same note, when of course we think about best practices and so on, implement backup validation. So build something, probably different server and so on, which will always restore your backup and validate that you can restore data after backup is taken. Because backups which you cannot restore, they are no good. It's just simply waste of time, waste of resources, and waste of disk space. Second way how you can handle size thing, use differential backups. And think about it like that. If you have very large databases, there is a very good chance here that a majority of data in the database would be static. If you use only full backups without differential backups, there is a great chance that you are wasting your disk space. So for example, you have 1 terabyte database backup. If you need to maintain those databases, those backups, let's say for 7 days, you're talking about 7 terabytes, not counting transaction logs. If, on the other hand, you have less than 1% of data changing on the daily basis, and if you can just simply start to do differential backups daily and one full backup weekly, you are cutting the size of your backups pretty much on order of magnitude. So differential backups are great. The caveat here is that they will increase recovery time. So if you start to introduce differential backups to your system, of course, validate that the data change rate in your system is acceptable for differential backup. Design your differential backup strategy and your backup strategy in general based on that change rate and the size growth of differential backups, and of course, test your RPO. And finally, which perhaps is the most important part here, fortunately, SQL Server allows you to control backup and design backups on per file group level. So technically speaking, you are not required to backup entire database all the time when you have some read-only file groups, and we will talk about it later. And also, you are not required, in Enterprise Edition at least, to restore entire database backup at time when you are restoring the database after disaster for the database to become available. And that one is the key when you start to think about your recovery and your disaster recovery strategy and your RPO and RTO metrics to begin with. So, fortunately, we are covered because in majority of cases we have different availability requirements for different kind of data. Again, think about it from a standpoint when we have our OTP, when we have our order entry retail shopping cart system, which is accepting customer orders. If disaster happens, it's incredibly critical for you to bring current OTP data online and allow customers to continue. Again, customers placing orders, your company is not losing money. So it's main and most important thing. On the other hand, when you talk about old, more static data, which is used for analysis, which is used for reporting, of course, it's very important for business to be able to run it. But at the same time, it's not customer facing, at least not external customer facing. And you have some flexibility and you have some additional leverage here to design your disaster recovery strategy in the way which will allow you to recover the data a little bit slower. Finally, if you think about your completely old data, static data and so on, you may not have any SLA at all. Maybe again, it's kind of data, and I saw those cases many times when the data is not available for quite a long time and nobody noticed until customers or maybe some infrequent use case requires to access the data. So it's entirely possible that even if you have, well, some data in the database, you may operate just fine without well, serious impact having just part of your database available. And to make matter better, when you think about databases which are very large, and to think about databases which are well, retaining data for quite a long amount of time, amount of data which is not important is usually significantly well, bigger compared to amount of data which is critical and needs to be online, which again gives you a lot of flexibility. The problem here, or well, let's say the downside here, or that your database needs to be properly architected on file group and file group level, let's say it that way, so you can utilize and benefit from piecemeal restore and partial database backup. Let's start with piecemeal restore and let's look at our database structure to begin with. So when we think about our typical database structure, we have multiple different elements when we start to think about file and file group level. We have a log file, which is usually one file per database, of course. We have a primary file group. You know, when you create file group, you usually have one primary MDF file and one log file. And in many cases, people just stop here doing it pretty much like that, placing everything to the same place, which is obviously not very optimal. But in any case, in addition to primary file group, you may have multiple secondary file groups, and you can put some tables and some objects to those secondary file groups. And finally, if you talk about additional technologies like in-memory OTP or file stream, some external file technology in that particular case, you would deal with them on, well, logically in database, but physically on disk as a set of separate files. And it would be separate containers, separate file groups, if you think about that, which will become the part of your database. So if you talk about piecemeal restore, you have a requirement that your database needs to have your primary file group, your log file, and your in-memory OTP file group to be available, available for the users. But in any case, key point here is that if you properly spread your data between different file groups, secondary file groups, and so on, you may architect your disaster recovery restore process in the way which will provide you an ability to recover your data on file group per file group level and bring your database online in the partial manner. So as an example of ideal database setup for our shopping cart system, I would do something like that. I would again create primary database, primary file group, which would be completely empty, very, very small, and will contain only system objects. Again, it will help me to recover in case if I need to recover, and it's very easy to support when your primary file group does not have any data. Next, I will create a file group which will contain some catalog entities which are going to be required for our system to be online to support our order entry processes. Again, customers, articles, warehouses, fulfillment centers, things like that. Next, I will start to split my orders between different file groups. I will create a file group for my current year orders. I will create a file group probably for the last year. May create another file group or set of file groups for my old orders, and so on, so on, so on. So now, when we are going to recover our database, generally, I need to just recover my very small primary empty file group and my catalog file groups, and only that set of order data, set of file groups with orders, which I need, which most likely would be, for example, current year. And as you can guess, time to recover that particular subset of file groups would be significantly smaller compared to time to recover entire database and 5, 10, 15 years worth of orders if you maintain them there. So very good, can help you a lot and can significantly simplify your disaster recovery strategy in terms of achieving your recovery time objective metrics. Very good technique when you think, and probably must-have technique when you start to think about very large databases. So what would you do, and how I would really suggest you to design your file group layout in order to make it most efficient? Like I already said, I usually keep my primary file group empty just because it simplifies my management. So if this is a row, I always will need to think where to put my data. I cannot put my data to primary file group by, you know, by mistake. So keeping file group, primary file group empty would just make your database management simpler. And again, if you have some data corruptions and so on, the chance that you have your primary data corruption, primary file group data corruption is smaller. Second, put your entities, related entities together. So for example, there is no need to separate orders and order line items if both of them will need to be online at the same time. So again, I'm not talking about time separation, like orders for 2020, orders for 2019, and so on, but I'm talking more about logical separation. So I may separate orders from 2020 and 2019, but I will put orders 2020 and order line items 2020 to the same file group together. So again, think about your data recoverability and requirements. What do you need to have available for your database to become available, and place those data, those things to the same, those entities to the same file group. And on the same note, keep all table objects together. There is very little need nowadays to separate your clustered and non-clustered indexes, or your clustered indexes and your large objects from each other, because in reality, more likely than not, you are going to have everything residing on the same SAN and potentially the same set of spindles, and anyway, and you are going to utilize the same network path to access them no matter what. If you start to split your clustered and non-clustered indexes between different file groups, it will make your life significantly more complicated when you are going to recover database in case of any database corruptions. So my suggestion, just don't bother, put all objects, all table objects to the same file groups. It will just simply simplify, make your life better and easier. And when we talk about general situation, it's again kind of different performance, maybe not design, but more like performance consideration. If your file group contains volatile data, the data which is changing all the time, create multiple data files in that file group. I usually start with 4 files per file group, and in majority of cases it's enough, and in some cases you need to fine-tune it. But for volatile data, again, I'm usually just starting with 4 files. If data is read-only, it's not really required, and you can end up with 1 file and be just fine here. But while volatile data would benefit from having multiple data files here. And of course, the last thing which I would suggest, if you have some read-only data in your system, or data which becomes read-only after some time, like again, maybe orders from last year, orders from 2 years ago, and so on, put them to the separate file group which you can mark as read-only. And the main reason here is that if you can separate your data, which is read-only data, from your modifiable data, you can benefit from another very good feature of SQL Server, which is called partial database backup. You don't need to include your read-only data to your daily or weekly or monthly full backups, because your read-only data can be backed up once and just simply restored after that, as long as database, as long as file group is marked as read-only. So just to give you some idea, think about our typical, again, database architecture. When you have several modifiable file group, and you have one file group called all orders, which is read-only file group, which you are dealing with, like again, orders from very old time ago. So you can design your database backup strategy in the following way. First of all, you need to have that file group physically be marked as read-only. And if you make any changes in that file group, you will need to repeat the process again in terms of database backups. Okay, you can again mark that file group modifiable and next mark it read-only again. But remember to take a backup of that file group afterwards. So anyway, first step, you are taking you are making your file group as read-only, and next you are taking backup file group level backup of that particular file group or set of read-only file groups. Next, you will continue to operate doing regular database backup, full database backup, and so on, but you are going to use some specific keyword here, which is called backup read-write file groups. So for all practical purposes, you can think about that particular backup type like your full backup, which is not going to backup any changes, which is not going to backup any data from read-only file groups. So your full database backup and that particular configuration would consist of two files, your read-write file groups plus your read-only file group backup, which you took before. And after that, you are going to continue to operate normally. You can take differential backups, you can take log backups, and do it all the time. So pretty much do your general backup strategy with exception of excluding read-only file groups from the backup. Now, if you have disaster, you are just simply restoring it in slightly different way. First of all, you are restoring your main database, primary database based on your last full backup. Next, you are applying your transaction log. At that point, you can potentially bring your database online and being available to customers. And by the way, of course, if you have differential backups, you can utilize them as part of your restore sequence as well. But next, at some point, you can also restore all order file group from separate backup, and pretty much at that point your database will become normal again. So in any case, if you have read-only data, do that and utilize partial database backup, because it will significantly reduce your backup time, and it will significantly reduce your backup overhead and size of backup files. You can do it pretty much once and completely, well, you can backup your old orders file group once and you can completely forget about it after that for quite a while and save on a lot of disk space and a lot of hassle to do full database backup on daily or weekly basis. I'm not going to show you the demo for time's sake, so please download and play with the scripts. You will see how it works in action. So what are the challenges with partial database availability? Of course, if you need to query or if you need to access the data which is unavailable and resides on offline file group, you are going to have issues and you need to do something in your code to be protected from that. Fortunately, if you think about a partitioned view, you have a very simple approach. So if you are architecting your disaster recovery strategy correctly, you can just simply alter your view as part of your piecemeal restore, and you can eliminate and remove some data from your view, and therefore clients would not even try to access those particular tables. Well, you may do some additional things, like for example, if you are utilizing partition tables, and we are going to talk about them a little bit later, you can start to limit a number of partitions which are exposed through that view, and it will also allow you to avoid accessing some of old partitions which can potentially be offline in that particular part. But probably the best approach, which I would suggest to do to provide probably the most consistent data for your applications, is utilizing multiple views based on use cases which you need. So technically speaking, think about again a large amount of data, and if you have different workload, and if you know, for example, that your application and your OLTP workloads don't need to have access to all data, just create multiple views. You can create a view which will include your critical tables, which you expose to OLTP application and to OLTP application, and you can create another view which will give, for example, data warehouse workload and reporting access to everything. In that case, yes, you will still need to do something with your full view, but at least it will simplify and speed up the process for your OLTP application, because you don't need to do anything. It will just cover data which you are going to recover as part of piecemeal restore before your system will become available. Again, a few different options, just be creative here. Next is a question which I would like to cover is maintenance. And database maintenance basically, I am going to talk about two very major parts which we are doing probably every day or on every system. It's index maintenance and our database consistency check. So speaking of index maintenance in general, situation now becomes very interesting. I always, of course, like to do index maintenance. I always prefer to do index maintenance when I can do that. Unfortunately, more often than not with the current hardware, you may be in the situation that if your system especially runs 24/7, index maintenance overhead may become unacceptable. One of particular examples, if you are using synchronous availability group setup, and if you have fast hardware with fast CPU and fast disk subsystem, you can get to the situation when your index maintenance becomes so transaction log intensive, so it's generating transaction logs on very large scope and very fast, so you can simply overload your availability group log send queue, and as a result your system will be pretty much down. So be careful here, evaluate impact of index maintenance, especially with availability group. And by the way, in my blog I have a link to the video which talks about issues with hard disk in commit wait in synchronous edge replicas, which I can also again encourage you to watch. And see if index maintenance or design index maintenance strategy in the way which will allow you avoid any overhead or any impact to the system. Second, of course, align your index maintenance and backup strategies. So for example, if you start to use differential backups, you don't want to do index maintenance before differential backup, because it will just simply balloon the size of your differential backup. Basically, when I need to run index maintenance on my system, and if I have a differential backup in my backup strategy, I align my full backup schedule to run after index maintenance. So index maintenance and all changes after index rebuilds are not really included to my differential backups. Speaking of a database consistency check, of course, offload it to another server if it's possible. You can try to use replicas if you want to, or for example, what I prefer to do, if I have to build the server for backup strategy, for backup validation, basically process, I usually also piggyback on that particular process and I just run my checkDB as part of my backup validation. Another good option, which pretty much completely disconnect your database consistency check from your production cluster. And finally, which is probably the most important thing, use different strategies for different data. If you partition your data correctly, you would be able to do it in the way and you can be able to benefit from designing your maintenance strategy in the way which will take data and use cases and workload into consideration. Again, in our case, for example, you can consider to use indexes with relatively low fill factor without data compression or maybe with raw data compression on file group level for OLTP data. For static data, you may do very well high fill factor and do database consistency check much less often and so on. So think about it and again design your strategy in the way which will get benefited, which will benefit from different kind of data, different requirements and different workload. Don't do unnecessary job. For example, there is zero reason to do for example index rebuild on your old orders which are completely static and are not changing at all. You are just simply wasting resources. In any case, we spoke a lot about partition views, and I now would like to kind of circle back a little bit on available architectural approaches and talk about partition tables. Well, as funny as it sounds, when we start to talk about partitioning and data segregation and so on, partition tables become significantly more common, but on the other hand, it does not necessarily mean that they are the best choice. So when we think about partition table, probably easiest way to think about them like partition view in the nutshell, which is supported by SQL Server. So you are dealing with bunch of internal tables, partitions in that case, and the same time you have your logical table, which is partitioned at top of that. Big benefit of that you can work with the table transparently. And in the first part of our discussion, I spoke that every table in SQL Server is partitioned even when it has one partition. But generally speaking, when you think about partition table setup, your setup is transparent. So you need to query data, you are dealing with logical partitioned table. When you need to modify data, you are also dealing with that logical partition table. And SQL Server just spread your data modifications to internal partitions based on where data is located. You can technically put your data to the different file groups, your partitions to the different file groups. You can technically utilize different compression for different partitions, but that's pretty much all. You cannot have different schema here. You cannot have different indexing here. And more importantly, you cannot even have different statistics. So every, unfortunately, limitation of having 200 steps in statistics histogram applies to entire partition table, so you will have 200 step histogram, which is one and global across all entire partition table here. So again, it will allow you to utilize some of the features. Like again, you can technically with proper design spread your data across different file groups and architect piecemeal restore and partial database availability, but at the same time it's very limited. And for me, the biggest limitation is a single technology and single schema and single indexing when we are talking about entire partition table here. So where partition tables help us? First of all, huge benefit of partition tables, and even if we don't talk about any other factors which we can get from general data separation and data partitioning, is ability to import, to reduce overhead during data import and data purge. When we talk about data import and data purge processes in general, when we talk about any tables, partition or not, you are having the risk of locking your table if you start to execute data modifications in large batches. And large is actually very subjective thing. Large means slightly over 5,000 records, really. So when you start to do data modification in the batches, SQL Server may decide to escalate locks by default to the table level. And in that particular case, it will lock your table during data modifications for all other sessions. So it's completely possible, for example, that you are deleting data from 5 years ago, and that operation at the same time lock your table even for new data which is coming to the system, despite that you are dealing with completely different data subset. So if you have that particular problem, regardless again how big is your database and how well architected is your database, you can consider to disable lock escalation on the table level. Usually with the modern hardware it's not necessarily a huge issue, but remember that disabling lock escalation may lead to some performance and memory overhead. Well, it's a, like I said, it's usually not a big issue unless you are starting to deal with very large batches, like again millions or even, you know, hundreds of millions of rows at once. But I would not suggest you to use those batches to begin with. So disabling lock escalation on active OTP tables, which will need to run some batch operations, may be acceptable in majority of cases. But with partition tables, you have a better option. You can utilize partition switch. When we talk about partition switch, think about it like that. You have different partitions, which are partition, which are internal tables, internal completely internal tables combined on metadata level. So you can move those tables away from your main table, or you can import data by replacing that internal table with another table. When you have another table of exactly the same structure, which is residing on the same file group, which is identical to your original partition tables, and pretty much when you make when you can make the change on the metadata level on your main partition table. And that one is incredibly beneficial. So for example, you are doing some batch ETL data import to the table with, again, row-based table, comstore table, whatever. You can prepare your data in some staging area, doing all ETLs without impacting anything. And next, you can switch the data as partition to your main table on metadata level. Similarly, you can, probably even more common use case, you can purge your data in your particular table when you just simply switch your partition out or in some cases just truncate your partition, which is another option. So in any case, that particular scenario, purging, is often called sliding window pattern, purging through partitioning, I mean. Think about it like that, like requirement. You may need to have you may have a requirement that you need to keep only maybe 6 months of data in your main partition table, or maybe 1 year of data. So every month you would like to create a new partition for your next month, and you want to delete or purge partition with the data which is older than your retention period. And why it's good? It's really because, again, you can do, when you do it properly, you can do all those actions on metadata level without any data movement, data deletions, and so on involved. So to purge, you can do one of two ways. You can either switch partition to some temporary table and truncate the temp table afterwards, or you can simply truncate partition after, truncate partition in your table. In both cases, both operations would require just metadata. You will have some table lock, but the table lock would be held for very, very small amount of time just to perform that metadata modification in your table. Second, you need to create a new partition. And here is the caveat. If you create that partition by splitting your partition function and so on, at that point, challenge here would be that if your partition is not empty, it will first of all acquire your data lock, schema modification lock on the table, and next it will perform scan and data movement on your partition with the data which you are trying to split. So again, easy to avoid. Basically, what you need to do is just keeping one partition in your table empty and performing that split of empty partition, just have one partition pre-located, and in that case it could be a complete metadata operation. But it's something which you need to keep in mind, and you obviously need to have all routines configured in the database in the way which will allow you to support it. Well, put some alerting in place. I had some cases in my life when, for example, the job which created pre-allocated one empty partition failed. I did not notice it, which led to significant issues in the system when I started to, run the job again, when data spilled to my rightmost partition and led to data movement and table lock to begin with. But in any case, what I would like to say is that utilize sliding window, utilize table partitioning if you have requirement support sliding window pattern to begin with, to just maintain last X months of data. It would be very simple, and it would be very efficient from operational standpoint. Again, we have a demo of that which is available for download, but for time's sake, I am going to skip that. So finally, when we start to think about our data distribution or our, for example, data separation from each other, I cannot avoid talking about hardware. Well, nowadays we have very nice and very good storage. But unfortunately, that storage is very expensive. So for example, it's very common for storage to have, $5,000-$6,000 cost per terabyte, and now start to think about very large databases. If your database is 50 terabyte and you are paying $5,000 per terabyte, you are paying $250,000 to maintain that database on that fast storage. Well, you have availability groups, for example, for availability group for node setup, you are talking about $1 million just for storage itself. Again, very expensive. Good thing here that, again, when you think about your properly architected database, and when you think about different data which you have in the database, you don't necessarily need to have fast and very expensive storage for all your data. Again, OTP query, most important part of your database, yes, it will need to have that storage. Something older may benefit from, you know, enterprise 15,000 RPMs drives, or maybe even simple RAID 5 drive for very old and static data. Again, your old data in general does not need to have that very fast storage. It does not require that performance. It may not even be accessed all the time, and it's not very efficient to really to utilize that storage from cost standpoint. Well, good thing that again, when you are using your data separation, when you architect your file groups in the right way, you can put your data, you can spread your file groups across different tiers in your storage, different storage tiers, and you can dramatically reduce the cost of your database solution with proper approaches. Of course, you're going to have a couple of challenges when you need to start to move data from one file group to another, and I'm including the code which will allow you to see different methods how you can move data in action. To summarize, in Enterprise Edition of SQL Server, you can move data between different file groups online by utilizing online index rebuild. It's relatively easy to do with regular tables, but unfortunately, if you need to move individual partition in partition table, it will become significantly more complicated. In Standard Edition, you don't have online index rebuild, but you can move data between different drives, keeping that system online. You can also do something creative, and you can write some code, especially if you have version limitation, or especially if you need, for example, to change the structure of your table and do some kind of refactoring. So let's assume that you would like to restructure your database, and let's assume that you would like to move one table from primary file group to another file group. And by the way, remember to create multiple files in that secondary file group which you are going to create. So first of all, you can simply create some kind of temporary table on the data. By temporary, I'm not talking about SQL Server temporary table. I'm talking about some kind of, you know, temporary staging table to put to copy your data into. And one thing which I also would like to mention, well, of course, I'm talking about different file group here. But second, one thing which I would like to mention here is that keep an eye on data types if you start to talk about very large databases. Having integer primary keys on transactional tables and just 2 billion rows as part of data type values is definitely not enough in the modern system. Well, I saw many cases when people are reaching integer capacity and system were down for quite a long amount of time after that, because again, doing alter table on very large table is offline operation which is very, very time consuming. So if you have integer keys, pay attention and figure out how to change them to big int whenever it's possible. But in any case, what you can do, you can just simply create very small process which is going to copy data in background from your source to your target destination table, probably again just not probably, but utilizing some batches of rows, not very big batches, again, maybe 50,000, 100,000 and so on, but tune those batches to the way which will introduce the least amount of overhead. And often I also suggest people to just limit overhead by limiting number of schedulers which you can run that copy process for. Of course, when you start to run those particular batches, try to align your copy process by using clustered index clustered index keys and so on. It would be the most efficient way comparing to utilizing non-clustered indexes to define the batch. Plans would be significantly more efficient. So you can run that process for quite a long time. It would be running in background. It would not really affect majority of your it would not affect other queries if you do it right. And next, when you are done, when you copied everything which you copied before, you can just simply run the second phase of that process by copying tail of the data which has been appended to the table as part of that particular data movement, and finally renaming your old table to something different and renaming your new staging table to the same name like your old table head. Of course, you need to apply permissions. Of course, if your table, original table, has some data modifications in addition to insert-only pattern, which is shown here, you can also capture it by introducing some triggers after update, after delete triggers, and just copy ID of the records which have been updated, and just applying those changes or deleting those changes at the final phase of your data movement. But the process itself, like I said, is relatively transparent. You can use it if other data movement techniques are not working, or you can use it if you need to alter your table schema to address some of the issues. I'm using it pretty much all the time when I have to re-architect or realign the data. Coming back to our partition tables versus partition views discussion. You can pause the video and read all details on the screen, but in the nutshell, partition views are more flexible. You can have different schema and different indexes in different tables, and at the same time you may also get better performance because of better statistics and ability to mix different technologies. On the other hand, they are harder to deal with. First, you need to put some development efforts to support data modifications, and also there are some maintenance challenges. Think about a scenario when you have 5 years worth of data which you would like to partition on a monthly basis. You are dealing with 60 tables. Think about table alteration, for the example. This is the reason that in my reference implementation, I am going to mix both technologies together and get the best from both worlds. So I would create separate tables, individual tables for my current OOTP data, and for old data, data warehouse data and code data, I would start to partition with partition tables on the larger chunks. I don't necessarily need all flexibility here in terms of having different schemas and different indexes, and I would like to eliminate all complexity of dealing with very large number of tables. Finally, of course, I will put partition view at top of all those tables which I have in the system. Next, when I need to move data from one table to another, let's assume that we are talking about new months or something like that, I am going to move data from one file group to another using regular online index rebuild, and next after that I will switch my data as a partition to one of my big partition tables. Finally, of course, I will create the new tables when we need to deal with next month, for example, period, and alter my partition views. To make it even better, if I want to get the most from the system, I am going to combine multiple different technologies. So I will use in-memory OTP and in-memory optimized tables. I will keep all my catalogs and all my transactional OTP data. So I would be able to utilize native compilation to get the best performance from that part of the system. Next, I will use a B3 table, partition B3 table for my warm data, again, previous several months and so on. And finally, I will create a table or maybe several tables which will store column store data in big partition tables. So everything would be optimized for particular scenarios, for best use cases, and will provide best support for use cases which we may have around different kind of data. And finally, if I need to move data, it would be a little bit more complicated, but not that much. If, for example, I need to move OOTP data, in-memory OOTP data, to my B3 table, first of all, I will create some triggers which will capture the changes, updated records, deleted records, and so on. Next, I will create some table on my file group with main warm data table, use insert-select process similar to what you saw before during that session, and copy the data from memory optimized table there. Next, I will apply changes from my tables which collected our delta, which data modifications and data deletions. And finally, when it's done, I will continue to do the same approach. I will switch the table as partition to my partition B3 table, and I will create additional memory optimized tables for my next months and things like that. Eventually, when time comes, I'm going to move data from B3 to column store. Again, relatively simple process, switching that partition to a regular table, moving it to different file group, and rebuilding the data after that, switching it finally to the table with column store indexes. Well, again, we don't have time to look at demos with all details, but demos for the session include end-to-end implementation for both technologies, for both approaches, let's say. So you can download them, you can run it, and you can play with it and see how you can implement something similar in your system. So what are the challenges here? Of course, when we start to switch partitions back and forth, when we start to put additional data to the tables, we will need to alter our partition view. And one of the big challenges here, we also need to maintain correct check constraints, because optimizer needs to know what kind of data do we have in each table. Unfortunately, SQL Server has the limitation. When you add check constraint to the table, it will always scan one of the indexes to validate that constraint. And it will at the same time lock the table for duration of that particular scan. So one of workarounds here, instead of trying drop and recreate check constraint locking the table, consider to just simply create the set of check constraints when you create table to begin with. So for example, when you have a table for 2020 or 2021, I would create 12 check constraints, one for January, second for January and February, and so on, until the last check constraint for entire year. And when time comes, when I need to do that, I just simply drop a constraint which is no longer valid before I'm switching partition, and that operation would be very fast on metadata level. Basically, when SQL Server will start to optimize those queries, it will look at most restrictive constraint which you have in the table and make the right choice if the table needs to be accessed. So, quite simple to deal with, but it's one of the things which people constantly overlook and one of the things which are hard to address later. In any case, everything looks nice, everything looks simple, and everything looks very beneficial, but unfortunately there are several changes which you need to keep in mind when you are starting to deal with all that architecture. First of all, again, we spoke about it before, you need to keep in mind requirements to have your data online when you are accessing the data. When you start to utilize partial database availability and piecemeal restore, have something in your design, in your disaster recovery strategy, which will allow your system to operate. Basically, again, you may alter the views, you may do some changes on data access tier, but do something which will limit number of errors in your system, especially for OLTP queries and OLTP workload. Second, of course, you will have to deal with partition view management. In some cases you can automate it when you start to move data around, when you start to create new tables. In other cases you need to do it manually. It all depends how you would implement it. But again, it's something to keep in mind and some additional complexity which require you to maintain the system, and you cannot always implement it in set it and forget it fashion. You need to, well, be involved here. Next, you may have some issues when you need to start to support uniqueness across multiple tables. SQL Server, of course, does not allow you to create cross-table indexes. SQL Server also does not allow you to create unique indexes on partition tables unless you specify part of your partition column as part of your index key, and that may make some things a little bit more complicated. You can work around some of that, like for example, you can create some unique constraints or unique indexes on materialized views, but it's not the best option because they will introduce additional overhead which may not be acceptable on large tables. So I am also including the demo which will show you a couple of approaches which you can take if that use case is critical for you. Next, another issue which is technically can be overlooked. When you start to partition your table, remember that even if you don't specify partitioned column as part of your clustered index key, it will become the part of clustered index key. And as a result, it will also become part of non-clustered index key on all of your non-clustered indexes. Well, it's not necessarily a big deal, but everything goes to perspective. So, for example, if you put date time column, which is 8 byte, to one index, which collect, for example, 1 million records per hour for 1 year, you are going to talk about some gigabytes worth of data across each index. Again, you are potentially talking about some size increase, but after all, if we start to mix different technologies, and if you start to utilize data compression and especially constore indexes, you may save a lot here. So it's not necessarily very big deal, but it's still something to remember. In some edge cases, it may be a problem. And finally, and probably the most important thing, when you partition your data, when you rearrange your data, when you start to do more complex architecture with multiple tables involved, you may start to deal with execution plan regressions. Your queries would behave differently. So now you're not dealing with one simple table and one simple index, you are going to deal with a bunch of complexities inside. And just to put things well in a very graphical way, to put things as an example. So consider that you have a table which is partitioned based on ordered date column. And you may also have an index which is created on one of our different columns, like again, modified date index. If you create aligned index, which is also going to be partitioned, you are going to end up in a very interesting situation. You have your data sorted within each partition, but you don't have your data sorted within a table in general. So what will happen now? Let's assume that you are talking about some simple select, which would like to select some records after specific modified date, so column which is indexed. In your non-partition case, single table case, you will have a very simple execution plan, which will have just index seek, top operator, and will select three records, and after that will stop execution. Unfortunately, you are losing in that particular case ability to do that because data is not sorted in across the table. You have a data which is sorted across all partitions. So ideally, when you think about it, it should be relatively simple if you think about it. So you may consider a simple algorithm when you get top three records from each partition in your execution plan. Next, you sort all of them together, and next you will just return those three records back to your client. Unfortunately, when you execute it, you may have very different behavior. So SQL Server wouldn't necessarily do that smart thing. It may just decide to scan entire index, and you may have very significant performance impact and performance regression after you start to split your data between different tables and different partitions. So, well, you can handle it. You have different options how to do that, but you need to put additional code in place. And in many cases, you need to do it on case-by-case basis, query-by-query basis, and pretty much going through all regressed queries and optimize it. Unfortunately, we don't have time to go through the demo, but you can download the scripts and see several examples of how you can do it. Finally, to reiterate a few key points. When you start to deal with large and complex databases, architect them right. Start with the file groups and spread data between them and between different tables based on your workload, availability, and maintenance requirements. Use different technologies for different kind of data in different workload. There is no reason not to benefit from what's available in SQL Server. Think about your disaster recovery and think and design your strategy which will allow you to utilize piecemeal restore. And finally, test your implementation. When you are doing such a complex implementation, you will always have some regressions, especially on existing systems. Test your system with production-like data and significant amount of data in the database to make sure that you get and code and address those regressions before you go to production. That's pretty much everything which I wanted to say. If you have any questions about that particular topic or any other SQL Server topics, please feel free to email me. I will always be happy to reply. Thank you, and again, thank you for attending.